Okay, so let's start the class after the break. Let's talk about another important topic in pediatrics, that is hypothyroidism. Now, why this topic is chosen, okay, to discuss in this live classes? There is a big reason. Hypothyroidism or neonatal hypothyroidism is that condition which can lead to cretinism, okay? Cretinism means there is mental retardation occurring as a result of neonatal hypothyroidism, and that mental retardation, if not treated in time, okay, is irreversible. Or that brain damage which is done by hypothyroidism, if not treated in time, is irreversible. But if you know what are the signs and symptoms, and if you do the investigation in time, you can rightly pick the diagnosis and go for the treatment. So after this class, I'm sure you will be able to do that. Now, let's start with definition of hypothyroidism and some of the causes. And we can discuss some of the anatomy related to a thyroid gland as well. Now, hypothyroidism is a deficiency of thyroid hormone, which is secreted by thyroid gland, and a reduction of thyroid hormone action at the cellular level. Now, thyroid gland secretes three hormones, that is T4, T3, and what is the third one?
Calcitonin.
Calcitonin.
Very nice. Calcitonin. Excellent. That is not related with hypothyroidism, so we are not even talking about that, okay? But you should know the name. So, hypothyroidism means the thyroid hormone, which are T4 and T3, they are decreased. They are not properly secreted by thyroid gland, and some rare, phenomena maybe. There is a good level of thyroid hormone, but they are not acting properly at the cellular level. That can also happen. There are two major forms of hypothyroidism in children: congenital and acquired. A congenital hypothyroidism develops during gestation, and the signs and symptoms are present right from the time of birth. But acquired, the onset usually occurs after 6 months of the age. Now, before we go into the detail of the disease, let's talk a little bit about thyroid gland. Now, see here, the normal location of thyroid gland is at the neck, okay, in front of the trachea. Now see it in this picture. Let me explain it. See here, this is thyroid cartilage. This is thyroid cartilage. Here is the hyoid bone. Okay, so from thyroid cartilage onwards, larynx will be started. And this cricoid cartilage cannot be seen because this isthmus is blocking it. Now, thyroid gland has two lobes, okay? This is right lobe, this is left lobe. And there is a connecting structure which is called isthmus. So this isthmus is present right, okay, anterior to cricoid cartilage, as well as first tracheal ring. This is the important anatomy here. Let me accept some of the students, they want to join, okay. Now share. So this is the thyroid gland, okay? And look at the blood supply of thyroid gland. The blood supply is from so many different sources. Superior thyroid artery is coming from above. Inferior thyroid artery is going from below. This is inferior thyroid artery, which you can see here. Okay, see this one. Very rich blood supply. So any trauma or injury to the thyroid gland or during surgery also, it can bleed a lot. Now let's go to some of the physiological aspect. Thyroid gland, okay, secretes two different type of hormones, or you can directly say it secretes three hormones also. It depends how you answer. Thyroid hormone is one, calcitonin is another one. So it has two hormones. But if you take T4, T3 and calcitonin like that, then it will become three. Now, this thyroid gland, if I talk a bit of histology, a thyroid gland is composed of thyroid follicle. This follicle, okay, see that these are the individual follicles. Okay, this is shown in another way. At the center of this follicle, there is colloid. This is a substance which has a lot of protein known as thyroglobulin. This thyroglobulin is utilized for the synthesis of thyroid hormone. And iodine is very much necessary for the synthesis of thyroid hormone. Without iodine, that person will suffer from hypothyroidism because thyroid hormones cannot be synthesized. Apart from this follicular cell, we have got parafollicular cell or C cell of the thyroid gland. Look at this schematic diagram. These blue cells are the parafollicular or C cell. Now, they secrete calcitonin hormone. So these are very, very important knowledge for us, very basic things. Let's move on. Now, before I move into the pathological aspect, let's talk about one very, very important physiological aspect. What do you mean by negative feedback in thyroid gland? Okay, all of the students, please pay attention here, okay? This is very important part of this class. Now, see here. Now, this hypothalamus, okay? Hypothalamus is a part of our brain. It secretes TRH. This TRH. What is the meaning of TRH, guys?
Thyroid releasing hormone.
This is called thyrotropin releasing hormone. Okay, not only thyroid, thyrotropin releasing hormone, because thyrotropin is another name for TSH. So it helps to release TSH. So it is called thyrotropin releasing hormone, which is secreted by hypothalamus. Now, it acts on anterior pituitary. Okay, this is anterior pituitary. Then from anterior pituitary, TSH would come out, thyroid stimulating hormone. Now this TSH will act on the thyroid gland. It acts on thyroid follicle and it stimulates that thyroid follicle to produce T3 and T4. So TRH stimulate TSH, TSH stimulate thyroid gland, and from there T3 and T4 would be released. Now what will happen? This T3 and T4 will give negative feedback to both TRH and TSH. Now negative feedback means if the concentration or level of T4 and T3 is high, they will block the further release of TRH and TSH. That's how they balance each other. Now if this mechanism is not there, you know, then we have overproduction of hormone all the time. This will be a big, big problem to the body. But that is balanced by negative feedback. So let me repeat again. The T4 and T3, which are released by the thyroid gland, will give negative feedback to TRH and TSH. That means it is inhibiting the release of them. Now let's talk about some pathology immediately. Then only you will understand this. Now, for example, this thyroid gland is secreting large amount of T4 and T3. That condition is known as hyperthyroidism, hyper or thyrotoxicosis. Now, what will happen? These hormones are at excessive level. Now, they will give more negative feedback because more hormone will give more negative feedback so that TRH and TSH will be very, very decreased. This is very important knowledge. Now, opposite to that, if thyroid gland is secreting very less hormone, like decreased T3, decreased T4, it cannot give proper negative feedback or it cannot inhibit or block TRH and TSH. So what will happen now? More TRH and more TSH will come from above. Okay, this is what negative feedback is all about. Now, after this knowledge, let's talk about what are the effects of thyroid gland in our body. Now, see there, thyroid hormone increase the basal metabolic rate. So for the basal metabolic rate, we need thyroid hormone. What does that mean? In case of hypothyroidism, the basal metabolic rate is very slow. Okay, very slow. But in case of hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis, basal metabolic rate is very high. That is very, very important knowledge. Another one, it affects many target cells throughout the body, and some of the effects on those target cells are, it increases protein synthesis, it increases the bone growth, it increases neuronal maturation or brain maturation, and it also increases cell differentiation. This means cell growth. The smaller cells are getting mature. Now let me highlight some more point here. Without thyroid hormone, bone growth cannot occur, especially the cartilage growth. That's why hypothyroid cells are short than other. So they are stunted. They look very, very short in height. One more point, neuronal maturation or brain maturation. Without thyroid hormone, in first 2 years of life, brain cannot mature, and that can lead to mental retardation later on. This is absolutely important knowledge. Okay, so let me highlight this. Bone growth and neuronal maturation. You should never forget this. Now, after thyroid hormone, what is the effect of calcitonin? Okay. See there? Now, the effects of calcitonin is on the calcium metabolism. It is secreted by thyroid parafollicular or C cells, and the stimulation is when blood calcium level is high. This is the stimulation for the release of calcitonin. And what it does, it lowers calcium level by slowing the calcium releasing activity of osteoclast. Okay? So it doesn't allow absorption or resorption of the bone. It lowers calcium by slowing the calcium releasing activity of osteoclast. That means the bone resorption is decreased. And one more function, it also increases the excretion of calcium by the kidney. So overall calcium level will be decreased. So this is the function of calcitonin. Exactly opposite of parathyroid hormone. Now, after this, you know, knowledge about anatomy and physiology, let's talk about what are the causes of hypothyroidism. Now, there are two major subcategories of hypothyroidism, which are primary and secondary. Now, see there, primary hypothyroidism means that there is decrease in thyroid hormone secretion, which is caused by a damaged, defective, or absent thyroid gland. And in case of children, okay, the congenital hypothyroidism is one of the most common cause. That means thyroid gland is not formed at all sometimes. It is absent inside the body. Sometimes it is very small. Sometimes it is not present in the normal area. It is present in some other area, and very small, you know, part of the thyroid gland is present. So all these things may be there. And another one is hypothalamic and pituitary hypothyroidism, or central or secondary hypothyroidism. That means there is a failure of the mechanism which stimulates TSH synthesis and secretion. So both TRH and TSH may be decreased in this type of hypothyroidism. Now, let's talk about congenital hypothyroidism. So what are the causes and important points? Now see there, the congenital hypothyroidism may lead to permanent hypothyroidism and transient hypothyroidism. Now, permanent hypothyroidism is because of these factors like thyroid dysgenesis. Thyroid gland is not properly developed. And one of the important cause is agenesis. It is not formed at all. It is absent. Another is ectopia, means it is not present in the normal site. And third one, it is smaller than the normal. And the level of hormone may not be enough. Very easy to understand. Another may be iatrogenic. This is doctor induced. And how? Okay. How it causes that? The important point here is maternal exposure to iodine, okay, 131. Now this is called radioactive iodine. This radioactive iodine, if we give to the mother during pregnancy, we should never be given. It is absolutely contraindicated, but somebody gave it, you know, by mistake or by negligence. Then that radioactive 131 can badly damage the baby's developing thyroid gland. It permanently damages the thyroid gland. Now, the second one, this is actually not iatrogenic. These are the genetic defect in embryogenesis. Okay, so I should write it a little bit separately. This is not iatrogenic. These are some genetic defect in embryogenesis. For example, some enzyme like peroxidase, that enzyme is not developed. And peroxidase enzyme is very, very necessary for the synthesis of thyroid hormone. Now, after that, let's talk about transient hypothyroidism. A transient means only for a short duration after the birth. Okay, only for the a short duration. Now, that can happen because of iatrogenic. That means if mother is taking antithyroid drug. If mother is taking antithyroid drug. Now, can anyone tell me what are those antithyroid drug? What are the names?
Propylthiouracil.
Okay.
Carbamazole.
Good. Very good, Ujair. Excellent. So these are propylthiouracil, carbamazole, and methimazole. Okay. Propylthiouracil, also known as PTU. Carbamazole and methimazole. These are called antithyroid drug. If the mother is taking this drug, then this drug may cross the placenta and can damage a baby's thyroid gland for a short duration, which leads to transient hypothyroidism. Another cause is maternal TSH receptor blocking antibody. They can also cross the placenta and can block the function of thyroid gland in the baby. That can happen in a chronic autoimmune thyroiditis in case of mother. Now, on the other hand, okay, on the other hand, what are the causes of acquired hypothyroidism? Now, look at the list here. Chronic autoimmune thyroiditis, and the most important example is Hashimoto's thyroiditis. In Hashimoto's thyroiditis, there are some autoantibody which can target the thyroid gland. So, thyroid hormone cannot be synthesized properly, or they can damage the thyroid gland as well. Drug-induced hypothyroidism can be caused by antithyroid drug. See that? Propylthiouracil, methimazole, and carbamazole. These are the name. Another drug which can cause hypothyroidism as its side effect is lithium. Now, this lithium is used for the treatment of bipolar disorder. If somebody is having mania and depression, okay, then we can use this drug for the treatment. But this is a very toxic drug. It can badly damage the kidney as well as thyroid gland. Another cause may be endemic goiter. Okay, let me use the highlighter. Endemic goiter. Now this endemic goiter means there are some places in this world which are very deficient in iodine, okay, the salt which is present there, or you know, some water which is present there is very deficient in iodine. And if those people are not taking extra iodine, then they can suffer from goiter. Now the meaning of goiter is enlarged thyroid gland. By any cause, that is goiter. And the most common cause is iodine deficiency. Another one is environmental goitrogens. There are certain vegetables which are considered goitrogens, means they inhibit, okay, they inhibit the synthesis of thyroid hormone. One of them is cabbage, okay? Cabbage, and another is cauliflower. But I'm not telling you these are, you know, bad type of vegetables, okay? What I am saying here is, if we take these every day, okay, in a non-stop way, for example, then only they may cause hypothyroidism leading to goiter. Otherwise, we need all type of vegetables. They are important for us. Non-important point I am going to tell you here. Why there is goiter in hypothyroidism? Okay, that is a question which is commonly asked by many teachers. Now, I'm asking to you this question, so anybody can answer to me why hypothyroidism leads to goiter?
The TSH will be secreted.
The particular secreted to decrease the iodine deficiency.
Hypertrophy, okay, of the thyroid gland.
Wait, 1 minute. Israr? Yes, Israr, you can answer this.
Hyperplasia of the thyroid follicular still because of deficiency of iodine.
Okay, I will give a chance to another student. Yes, I forgot to check the name here. Anybody can speak now? Who can answer this? Sadat? Yes?
Sir, positive feedback to stimulate more.
Okay, Adil, yes, say it. Continue, please. Yeah.
Because in hypothyroidism, there is less production of thyroid gland, thyroid hormone. Uh-huh. So there will be positive feedback by the TSH.
Mm-hmm.
So there will be stimulation and there will be enlargement of the neck and the thyroid gland.
Very good. Excellent. Okay, excellent. That is a very good explanation he has given. So that is the reason. So let me repeat it once again. In iodine deficiency, thyroid hormone synthesis is very less. So that less thyroid hormone cannot give enough feedback to the anterior pituitary and hypothalamus. That means more TSH is coming from there. And TSH is called thyroid stimulating hormone. It will stimulate those thyroid follicle and they will become bigger in size. This is called goiter. Very easy explanation, okay? But you need to remember that negative feedback. That's why I told you in the beginning of the class. Okay, now another cause of acquired hypothyroidism may be irradiation of the thyroid gland, which can damage the gland. And these are therapeutic radioiodine, which is used for the treatment of hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. One of the way we treat thyrotoxicosis is radioiodine, but that radioiodine will permanently damage the gland. And after that, that patient will change into hypothyroid patient. External irradiation of non-thyroid tumor is another cause of destruction of thyroid gland. Let's take example of head and neck tumor or cancer. Now, one of the way of treatment of cancer is radiotherapy. And that radiotherapy, if given in head and neck area, it will definitely damage thyroid gland. Now, that thyroid gland cannot secrete thyroid hormone, leading to hypothyroidism. Another cause may be surgical excision, okay? Either because of tumor, cancer, or even because of hyperthyroidism. One of the ways is surgical excision. Now, after excision, definitely there will be hypothyroidism. So these are some of the causes of acquired hypothyroidism. Now, let's move on. Now, let's talk about what are the clinical features of congenital hypothyroidism. Now, these are the findings which occur during birth and first two postnatal weeks or first 15 days after birth. Now, usually the gestational age or gestation period is more than 42 weeks. This is called postterm baby. They are usually postterm baby. The birth weight is also big, more than 4 kg. So they are known as large for gestational age baby, LGA. In day before yesterday only, we talked about that. If we examine their eyelid, hands and feet, they are edematous. Okay, they are edematous. There is prolonged neonatal jaundice. I discussed this in our neonatal jaundice class. Without thyroid hormone, the enzyme which is causing conjugation reaction is immature. So without mature enzyme, conjugation of bilirubin cannot happen. That is the cause for prolonged neonatal jaundice. Poor feeding, because these babies are lethargic. They sleep most of the time. So there will be poor feeding. Even they choke sometimes. Hypothermia is decreased temperature, which is very common features of hypothyroidism. Protuberant abdomen means umbilical hernia, okay, or also known as pot belly. Umbilical hernia or pot belly, very common feature. And another important one, large anterior and posterior fontanelle, especially the anterior fontanelle, which is large and doesn't close at its particular time. Now, do you still remember at which time anterior fontanelle is closed?
18 months.
18 months.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. 18 months, okay? But in this condition, probably it doesn't close at 18 months. It may remain there for 2 years or even 3 years. And posterior fontanelle is closed at around 6 months, which doesn't close. And it remains big as well. Now, if that baby, okay, for example, after 1 month of age, what are the clinical features or finding in the baby who have congenital hypothyroidism? Now, the baby will fail to gain weight and there is poor sucking ability. I already told you that baby sleeps most of the time, very poor appetite, poor feeding. Decreased activity as well as lethargy. The baby is not alert. The baby is not active. Baby is not moving its limbs. Baby may not look towards you or towards here and there in the room. For example, if we you know, put some light in the room, then baby should immediately look there. But it doesn't do so. That is called decreased activity. Umbilical hernia is an important feature. Umbilical hernia, let me highlight it. This umbilical hernia is a very common feature of hypothyroidism. Infrequent and hard stool, this is the constipation. This is a very, very important feature of congenital hypothyroidism. Parents are quite worried. Why? My baby is not passing stool very frequently. Okay, probably the baby is having hypothyroidism. The skin looks dry and yellow. Now, this yellow or yellowness is called carotinemia. This is excessive beta carotene in the blood. This beta carotene is a precursor substance for vitamin A. Okay? Now, one important point I told you during my 5th semester practical session, this is a differential diagnosis of jaundice. But in jaundice, there is staining of bulbar conjunctiva, but in carotinemia, that bulbar conjunctiva is not yellow. Only other parts of the body is yellow, and that is how we separate these two conditions. Macroglossia means big tongue. The tongue is big in size, and sometimes the baby keep on protruding the tongue outside. Another clinical feature would be generalized swelling or mixed edema. The face looks puffy, okay? The face looks puffy and it looks like the whole body swollen. This condition is known as mixed edema. Now, this edema is not because of fluid collection. This edema is because of connective tissue substance, okay? Which are known as mucopolysaccharide. So there is deposition of mucopolysaccharide in many organ of the body, which results in mixed edema. The cry of this baby is very hoarse. This occurs because of laryngeal involvement. Again, those mucopolysaccharide, they go and deposit inside the larynx. So the quality of the voice will change. And another important point, this baby will lag behind in comparison to the development of other normal child. that is called delayed developmental milestone. This is because of brain damage. Brain will badly suffer in case of hypothyroidism in the young age. Now look at this picture here. Okay, look at this picture and please try to find out what are the physical findings you can see here. Actually, it is written here. Okay, it is written. So you just try to, you know, see that in the picture. So let me show you here. So let's start from here. See this. This is called umbilical hernia. Umbilical hernia. Okay. The overall abdomen looks protuberant. Okay. The overall abdomen looks protuberant. Now this baby's face, see this. The face looks puffy or swollen. Okay, look at the eyelid here. The eyelids are swollen. And even the tongue I can see protruding from outside. Okay. And then this same baby actually, look at the tongue here. It is protruding from outside and very big tongue. This is called macroglossia. Okay. Because of the puffy eye or puffy eyelid, the baby will close the eye most of the time. Another important feature. This baby is very lethargic or inactive and sleep most of the time. Doesn't show any interest in feeding. And sometimes even the feeding cannot be swallowed properly. There is repeated choking episode. These all are very important features which are shown here. And one important point I like to highlight right now. We want to take this type of picture, okay? When the baby is delivered in the hospital or when this type of baby is brought to you. And after diagnosis, we want to give thyroid hormone to this baby, which is called thyroxine. Now, there is an amazing response because of the thyroxine hormone. And after this baby is brought to you, probably after 6 months, 1 year or 2 years, you cannot even identify this is the same baby. So that's what I mean by early diagnosis and proper treatment. Now, if this baby is not picked in time, if this type of features will be continued, this baby will have mental retardation later on. And the baby will have very, very poor IQ. The baby cannot go to school, cannot study, do not have proper developmental milestone. This is a burden to the parents. And in this competitive world, if a child is born like that, or if the child is grown like that, what's the use of that, isn't it? So this is a huge job of a pediatrician. This has to be diagnosed right after the birth or very early, if not at birth. And we should confirm it by some investigation and start the treatment. Now see this picture, okay? Look at it. This is the infant a few months after starting thyroid hormone replacement. This is the same infant, okay? See there? Look at this infant and this infant. Now, where is the umbilical hernia? Okay, I cannot see it. The baby looks much alert than before. The tongue is not protruded outside. The baby can see properly. There is no puffy eyes. So there is a dramatic response because of this thyroid hormone. Now, let's talk about some of the clinical features of acquired hypothyroidism, and the remaining part we'll talk in the next class. Another important feature of acquired hypothyroidism is stunting. The child do not gain height because of the cartilage are not growing. There is coarse facial feature, dry skin with carotenemia, hoarse cry, and large tongue. So most of these features will persist. Or even in acquired hypothyroidism, means, remember the definition is, if hypothyroidism occurs after 6 months of age, the child is still small. So most of the features which we have seen in congenital hypothyroidism, it can occur in acquired as well. That is the meaning. The umbilical hernia can occur. Muscular pseudo hypertrophy is occurring, that is enlargement of the arms and leg muscle in this condition. That is because of the deposition of fat as well as mucopolysaccharide substance. There is delay in eruption of the teeth and in shedding of the primary teeth as well. The loss of the teeth is also delayed, and delay in eruption of the new teeth is also delayed. There is infrequent and hard stool, which is called constipation. It will continue to happen. And there is generalized swelling or mixed edema, which is a very, very important feature in this type of children, even in acquired hypothyroidism. Okay, so let me stop here. We'll continue next time. Okay, so let's start freshly. Let's talk about laboratory diagnosis of hypothyroidism. So what are the tests you like to order? The most important one is TFT, a thyroid function test. So we do serum TSH, T3 and T4. Now decreased level of T3 and T4 is the first thing, and that shows this is a case of hypothyroidism. Now, which type of hypothyroidism? Is it primary or central? For that, you need to go for TSH. Increased TSH is there for primary hypothyroidism, and decrease or low TSH is there for central hypothyroidism. Okay, this is very, very important. Central means it's hypothalamic or pituitary. After that, we go for thyroid antibody test. Now, in case of autoimmune thyroiditis as the cause of hypothyroidism, the thyroid autoantibodies may be present. The few important examples are given here. They are thyroid peroxidase antibody. Okay, thyroid peroxidase antibody. See here, TPO. Okay, also known as anti-TPO antibody in different textbook. And another one, thyroglobulin antibody. Now, they are diagnostic of autoimmune thyroiditis. One of the example is Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Now, what else? Okay. Apart from them, we like to do so many other investigations. Depends, like even lipid level can be done in case of hypothyroidism, and there is usually hyperlipidemia present. Even CBC can be done. Macrocytic anemia can occur in hypothyroidism. Okay, ultrasonography of the neck area can be done. So you can list a lot of other important investigation, but those two which we have listed are the most important to find the etiology. Now, regarding the diagnosis of hypothyroidism, you need to have all three things together: good history taking, good physical examination, followed by investigation. Now, in older infant and children, hypothyroidism is suspected by the presence of an enlarged thyroid gland, which is known as goiter, on examination of the neck. This is one point. Failure to maintain a normal rate of linear growth because they cannot attain height in hypothyroid state. The symptoms and signs of hypothyroidism, which we have discussed before, and family members having thyroid disorder. This is an additional point. So in this situation, hypothyroidism is suspected. Among the patients who have hypothalamic and pituitary hypothyroidism, now you have to suspect in some other way. And what are those? Remember, from where TSH is coming, from anterior pituitary. So there must be other hormonal deficiencies as well, like growth hormone deficiency. Okay, then ACTH deficiency, isn't it? So some other example, FSH and LH deficiency. So because of this, some other clinical features will be there, like insufficient growth hormone secretion leads to dwarfism, low gonadotropin with lack of pubertal development, and less often low cortisol secretion, which can lead to under secretion of hormones from adrenal gland, that is mainly cortisol. Now, the last part is the management. Now, I told you repeatedly in the previous class, this hypothyroidism is so important condition in case of neonate or babies that early diagnosis is, okay, the challenge for the doctor, and the doctor, okay, should pass in that challenge, then only the baby will not have mental retardation later on. And the management after the diagnosis is easy and inexpensive. It is one of the easy type of therapy. And the drug is levothyroxine or L-thyroxine is the treatment of choice, okay, during infancy and childhood as well as in adult. It is the same drug. Now dose, it is usually given orally in less than 6 months, 10 to 15 microgram per kg per day per oral. 6 to 12 months, it drops to 68 microgram per kg per day. 1 to 5 year, 5 to 6 microgram per kg per day, or 75 to 100 microgram per day. Okay, 6 to 12 years, still dropping 4 to 5, and more than 12 years, 2 to 3. So one important, you know, message you are getting from this is, okay, younger the child, higher the dose of thyroxine. And this thyroxine is mostly utilized by the developing brain at this time. This is such an important point. Now, what are the precautions, okay, when we prescribe this hormone to the child? In appropriate doses and with appropriate monitoring, there would be no adverse effect on the baby. Infants to be monitored for signs of overtreatment. Sometimes there may be overtreatment, overdose of the medicine. And remember, it almost looks like hyperthyroid state now. So nervousness, hyperactivity, anxiety, tachycardia, palpitations, tremors, fever, diaphoresis, abdominal symptom, and weight loss may be there. But these all are features of hyperthyroidism because of the overdose. Now, thyroxine absorption is impaired by certain drug. If we give this drug together with thyroxine, like iron and calcium medication, okay, then they cannot be absorbed properly. Same thing can happen with high dietary fiber in food and certain soy containing infant formula. They also hamper the absorption. In this situation, the dose of exogenous thyroxine must be increased so that the balance may be there. Now, what is the prognosis of hypothyroidism in children? If infants get hypothyroidism, that is congenital hypothyroidism, the prognosis for normal intellectual and neurological function and linear growth is excellent, who are treated adequately beginning in the first few postnatal weeks. But the point is very clear here. If we diagnose them and treat them, the prognosis is excellent regarding intellectual, neurological, as well as linear growth function. Such an important point. Otherwise, they will be mentally retarded later on. They will be dwarf later on. Okay. Now, beyond 3 months of age, a delay in the diagnosis and treatment by adequate thyroxine therapy usually is associated with an increased risk of mental retardation. No doubt about it. After 2 or 3 years of age, no permanent intellectual impairment or neurological deficit occurs because by that time, brain is already developed. 90% of the brain develops within 2 years of life. Okay, so after that, if hypothyroidism occurs, probably brain is already developed. So no permanent intellectual impairment or neurological dysfunction. In older children, adolescent, failure to gain height. That is the only problem. Most of the other problems will not occur. So even in older children and adolescent, even if you miss the diagnosis for certain duration, nothing will happen. Not very serious, you know, problem. But in neonate and in infant, if you miss the diagnosis, okay, there will be serious damage to the brain leading to mental retardation later on. So this is the take-home message from this class. So at the end, please go through these questions, solve them, okay, on your own and confidently, and you should think you have done well in this topic. Thank you so much.